Good evening. Welcome to the Jacksonville History Show. I'm Jerry Spinks, President of the Historical Society. We're here today to bring you yet two more pieces of the great Jacksonville story. Joining me on the first section will be Ron Williamson from the Naval Air Station, and in the second section, Sam Farhat and his daughter Suzanne Vella will talk to us about the another portion of our community. I'd like to welcome, glad you are joining us tonight, and we're going to learn a little bit about two different sections of our city. Ron, it's a pleasure to have you here this evening.
Thanks, Jerry. Pleasure to be here.
Pleasure to be here. Ron is the base historian for the Naval Air Station.
Right.
Ron, well before planes landed on those well strips out there, there was a plantation along the St. Johns River.
Correct.
Tell us about it.
Well, yeah, there was a plantation. The site itself's got quite a history, as a matter of fact, long before the military moved into the site that people see today. But one of the bigger pieces of the history out there is a guy by the name of A.M. Reed and his family moved in here to the Jacksonville area and took over that entire site out there and grew crops. He was there for quite a while, him and his family. He kept a daily diary, as a matter of fact, the entire time he was there. And I was able to get a copy of that. I think the diary is the property now of the Florida Times Union downtown, so they have that in their files. Got some interesting facts and figures in there from the site because he kept such good detailed records while he was out there. He was also president of the Bank of St. John's because Jacksonville had two banks in the middle 1800s, and he was the president of the Bank of St. John's. And if you get some of the banknotes from that bank today, you can see his signature actually on the bottom of those notes are quite rare, but he was there.
When do we shift from these plantations to the military?
That started happening around 1905.
Is this picture pert?
Not quite yet. The military started moving in because the Florida Adjutant General at the time, J. Clifford R. Foster, was looking for a place for a National Guard, Florida National Guard, a guard site. And after surveying all of Florida, they finally decided that the best piece of property they could find was the site where Naval Air Station Jacksonville sits today outside of Jacksonville. So they started acquiring bits and pieces of that property for the Florida National Guard camp, and it started growing from that point on up until World War I. And then when World War I came, Jacksonville was selected as a site for a quartermaster training camp by the United States Army, and the Florida National Guard was sort of put on the side. And the Army started building the site up there, known as Camp Johnston, for World War I. And Camp Johnston was a quartermaster during the Mexican-American War with the U.S. Army. And of course, he was also one of the generals there for the Confederacy in the South. And so they named the camp after him, being a big quartermaster person that he was, and Camp Johnston started growing.
Wow. And then we began to move into the military, into the base in the configuration we are somewhat familiar with today.
A little bit. The Camp Johnston went on. Matter of fact, we have two photos here to give somebody an idea of what the base looked like here when it was Camp Johnston. We have quite a few of these panoramic photos that actually came out of the base. I have a collection, I guess, of like 150 of these, believe it or not, of the entire camp. And the amazing thing that happened with these photos is somebody came to our office and said, I was a young boy, I got to know the folks in charge of the camp, and I have this collection, if you want this, we don't want these anymore. And somebody literally dropped us off a complete collection of 150 photos, all labeled, and we know exactly where the locations are on the base today where these photos were taken. So we think that's a pretty amazing piece of history that we have here for Camp Johnston.
Wow.
And you can see they built just literally a ton of buildings here in World War I. We have one other one just to give the folks an indication of what the site looked like. This is actually Catholic Mass on a Sunday morning at the base. Somebody took a picture of all the Army
About
soldiers
period,
on the base.
What period of time was this?
We know this. This was right around the summer of 1917. So we know pretty much exactly when this photo was taken. It's a pretty amazing picture, and you can just get an idea of how many people were based at this camp at the time.
Wow.
People came here, World War I, they trained. We had a pier out the back end of the base that's gone today, and they literally shipped out for World War I here right out of the base after getting their training here out of Jacksonville.
That's amazing.
And they had plans, believe it or not, to expand this camp up to train 50,000 people. And it ended when World War I ended and the plans stopped there for the U.S. Army. So just another huge site. One other fact, I think, that's very interesting about Camp Johnson, I don't think is well known today, was there was a aviation school on the camp. Earl Dodd, a New York millionaire, came down here and decided it was a great site to open up aviation facilities.
Right.
And he started training people how to fly the Jenny, which was the airplane of the day. We have a model of one of these. Actually, this is a model of what the aircraft actually looked like that they flew out of the camp at NAS Jacksonville. And the amazing fact is, out of all the flight training they did in this not real modern type of aircraft, they didn't have one single accident the whole time they were training for a year there. And when armistice came, World War I ended, they asked all the aircraft that were at Camp Johnson to fly over downtown Jacksonville on the day the war ended to celebrate the end of World War I. So somewhere there should be a great shot of all these old Jennies flying over downtown Jacksonville to end World War I.
That was amazing.
This was the aircraft that was there.
People should know that you crafted that model.
Yes.
You made it.
Just a little model, something that we could put on display there in front of the quarter deck of NAS Jacksonville and let folks know what used to be there.
All right, Ron. Let's step through some photos mm-hmm. that really opened the book on history from this photo through Bob Hope, I think.
Yeah, pretty much. We brought a little sampling of the photos that we have here at NAS Jacksonville. We have some historic photos. They must have taken 50,000 or so photos because they were all numbered and labeled there up to about 1955, and we only have a couple hundred examples of those left today. But that's a photo of Camp Foster. It was after Camp Johnston closed down after World War I. Florida National Guard wanted their site back, so they started moving back in, but the Army held on to it for about 3 years and wouldn't give it back to the state of Florida. Finally, a fire hit all their storage facilities in Yukon, burned it down, and they were able to rename the site Camp Foster after the original Foster that got the military in there to begin with.
All right, let's step through some stories as our time winds down here.
Okay, that's first site. That's the very first plane assigned to NAS Jacksonville. That's a Grumman Duck. Came here in 1940, the commanding officer's private aircraft. And that was the first military plane actually assigned here to the Jacksonville area.
I've heard of Rosie the Riveter, but tell me about these two ladies.
That's a little different. The first planes were all fabric and wood. This is a great rare shot of a couple ladies actually sewing the fabric wings on one of the aircraft out there at NAS Jacksonville, getting ready to put those wings back on when they're finished doing the sewing on it.
A voice from my past, but only because I heard it on the radio, is this gentleman right here.
Bob Hope came to the station a couple times during World War II. This event here, they had him out there because they had a bunch of folks that were going to get their wings. They did a national radio broadcast across the United States, Bob Hope show, and then after the ceremony, he called up all the aviators and presented them with their new aviation wings at NAS Jacksonville.
That is an amazing story. Here is another piece of local history.
That's a real piece of history there. Nobody even knew that first photos existed at the very first Blue Angels Air Show when they dedicated Craig Field here in Jacksonville. Bernard Norton, who's a local person here, came to the office and said he thinks he had some photos, and that's what they were. So these were just discovered here in the late 1990s. Blue Angels didn't even have those, but that's a shot of Butch Voris and the very first flight of the Blue Angels here in Craig Field.
It's absolutely amazing. Tell us about this other first.
Yeah, another first here that for NAS Jacksonville, the very first African American to get his wings in the Navy was here at NAS Jacksonville. He went through the schools, got his wings here, and that's the shot there with the other aviators getting their wings about 1948 here at NAS Jacksonville. He went on to get shot down in Korea and was injured. He was trapped in his aircraft. Another pilot flying with him landed his plane, tried to get him out but couldn't. He ended up dying in his aircraft there, and the pilot that tried to rescue him, believe it or not, came back here about 1996 and got dedicated in a park we have for Medal of Honor winners there later on.
That's amazing. Many, many presidents have come through Jacksonville at different times in their careers.
Yes, we have. We had Roosevelt come through a couple of times here, once on his way to Key West to go fishing. Roosevelt Boulevard here in Jacksonville was named after him there after one of his visits. That's a picture of a young Ronald Reagan when he was just a fledgling movie star coming down here visiting folks there right after the Korean War here at the Naval Hospital.
And tell us about Congressman Charles Bennett.
Yeah, Congressman Bennett, big support of the military through his entire tenure through Congress. He was in there, 40, 50 years as a congressman, a long time. That's a very early shot right after the Korean War here in Jacksonville. As Congressman Bennett, as they're bringing back prisoners of war there from the Korean War here, right after the Korean War.
That's amazing. Yet another first. Tell us.
Yeah, another first. Ann Neffer, she was one of the first female pilots in the Navy. That's the squadron she's assigned with here early in 1974. Was with the Hurricane Hunters, who flew out of NES Jacksonville for probably 30 years or so before they were finally disbanded. But another good shot of first that happened here in Jacksonville, in the Jacksonville area.
Well, it's amazing to know all about the military's history and the connection and the great partnership we have with the military, and particularly the Navy. I want to thank you for all the work you're doing out there.
Sure.
I hope you will stay tuned for the second portion of our show. There's an amazing connection, as there is in many things, in Jacksonville. One of our guests, Susan Biller, is coming up. Her husband is involved with the P-3 Orions, which are stationed at the Naval Air Station. So stay tuned for the second set. Thank you.